Here again, so same thing as I begin with the short demo, this time with my iPod Touch and my Raspberry Pi. So I've mirrored my iPod Touch here. Okay, so now let's look for my Raspberry Pi. You can see my iPod Touch has managed to search for my Raspberry Pi using Bluetooth Low Energy. So let me connect to it. Okay, so you can see here, the LED has changed from red to green, indicating that there's a successful connection between both of them. So with this same program, I can toggle a blue LED wirelessly, toggle a yellow LED. At the same time, I also can send data back with the button press here. So let me press here. You can see I receive a value. I press again, I receive another value. So yeah, let's see how I managed to do this. Okay, so yeah, the first question is just a quick poll. How many of you have seen the first part? Okay, so I'll just do a short recap anyway. Okay, so what's on agenda? I'll revise some of the concepts in part 1. Then I'll handle some questions from the part 1 also. Then I'll move on to Raspberry Pi and iOS coding. This time I will not do the breakpoint demo because of time issues. Then I'll move on to the sniffer and some low-level BLE concepts that I did not cover earlier. Okay, so a quick refresher. So central and peripheral. The peripheral advertises to central. Central connects to peripheral. And these two terms, get and get. So get means advertising. What does the peripheral, in this case my Raspberry Pi, what does it tell the world before there's a connection between them? Then after the connection, the get, which defines services, characteristics, and descriptors. So what are these three? So on the top level, we have the get. Inside the get, we have the service. Inside each service are the characteristics. Each characteristics can take on this set of properties. Inside each property, you can have some optional descriptors. So, connection procedure. So, between central and peripheral, starting, the central scans and the peripheral advertises. So, the central receives the advertisement packet. With this advertisement packet, the central connects to the peripheral. So, once the connection is successful, the central will now discover services. Once services is discovered, then I'll discover characteristics. So this is good enough. You don't have to discover descriptors unless you have a special reason for doing that. Okay, so some questions for part 1. So there was a question last time, which version of Linux supports it? So Linux kernel 3.5 and BlueStacks 5.0. So can a peripheral block an unwanted connection? The answer is no, the peripheral cannot block, but the peripheral can disconnect the central. So there are some APIs available on the peripheral to disconnect the central. Okay, so who defines the attributes? The peripheral always defines the attributes. So it always defines services, characteristics, and descriptors. So I think the confusion came about because I wrote this bunch of code on the central. So the reason for me doing that, right, is because I already know what UIDs are available on the peripheral. So with these UIDs, I can immediately aim for the particular characteristics whenever I need to do something. Okay. So security, you can do Bluetooth pairing, but I strongly discourage you from using that because there's some weaknesses in the BLE security features. But this has been rectified in Bluetooth 4.2. But the problem is very few devices support Bluetooth 4.2. So yeah, avoid using the BLE security features. Okay. Data loss from using write without response for search write. So the possibility exists, but so far in my experience, data loss seldom happens. So the analogy will be like between TCP and versus UDP. So in TCP, there's acknowledgement going on, so it guarantees that data will always go through correctly. In UDP, there's no acknowledgement, but in practice, there's seldom data loss in UDP. But this can happen if you try to spam. If the central keeps sending a large amount of volume of data to the peripheral, then yes, data loss can occur. Okay, so before I move on to the part 2 proper, any questions up to this point?
Regarding packet loss, was your setup always that the devices were so close together, or did you also, if there's obstacles in between?
If there's obstacles in between, yes. If there's some interference, for example, in Wi-Fi, because it's the same frequency. So if you have your Wi-Fi is also heavily congested, yes, packet loss is more likely to result. So if you are really concerned with that, then use write instead of write without response. Okay. So I move on to part two. So again, the same thing, the functional requirements for this is the same as my Arduino. Red and green LED to indicate the connection status. Blue, yellow, and the button are... Okay, blue and yellow is controlled by the central. The button is for sending back data. So the hardware setup this time is a Raspberry Pi Raspberry Pi 2. But the B Plus and Model B also, they'll work fine. This time I also use a USB adapter. Okay, so architecture plan, exactly the same. Except of course the name is different now. The services and characteristics, the same two characteristics, one is in charge of the LED and one in charge of the button. So for the LED, whenever it receives the letter B or Y, the blue and yellow LED will be toggled. And whenever the button is pressed, a value will be sent back. Okay. So for Raspberry Pi, okay, I'm using Pi 2 and Arch Linux ARM. So the reason why I'm using Arch Linux, right, not Raspbian, is because on Raspbian, the Bluetooth stack is quite outdated. So there could be some bugs and some problems. So you may want to use a more cutting-edge distribution like Arch Linux for this purpose. Then the framework I'm using is Node.js. Again, this may seem very weird because Node.js is normally a web framework. So why am I using that? It's because of the BLE library. The BLE library for Node.js is called Blino. So this is actually one of the most mature you can find on the Linux platform. So because this guy, Satin Mystery, right, he actually aggressively maintains it. Yeah. So let me move to that first. Okay. So the Raspberry Pi. So okay, I'll import the Blino library. Then for the GPIO, I'm using on off. Okay, so here I'll define all the pin LEDs for the buttons and LEDs. So here for the button, right, this is actually an interrupt. So whenever the button is pressed, I've attached this callback here, button press, which is this function. This one will be called. So let's see what it does. Whenever the button is pressed, I'll increment the value and then I'll send it back. Okay. So let me skip this. So here I'm defining the get data. Let me move that. So here you can see the local name. Intro to Raspberry BLE, the service, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And two characteristics. One is named 10 and the other is named 20. 10, 20, 10, 20. Okay? So I put this service into an array. So now I define the characteristics. So you can see here the first characteristics, this is in charge of the LED with the property read and write without response. And the other one, read and notify. Okay? Read and notify. So here there's an extra function here, on char LED return. So this function will be called whenever the central sends B or Y. Okay. So now I define the service and then attach the characteristic to the service because a characteristic is part of a service. Okay. So now these are actually extra callbacks. Because the Raspberry Pi is not a microcontroller, so everything has to be, you have to acquire the resource and wait for the response. So here, state equals power on. Once the Bluetooth the Bluetooth has been initialized, then I'll start advertising. Then once the advertisement has started, then I'll attach the service. You can see here, the advertisement includes the service. Advertisement packet includes the service. That's why I have to set the service inside the advertisement packet. So here, whenever there's a successful connection, I'll turn the green LED on. Similarly, when it's disconnected, I'll switch back to the red LED. Okay, so notice I've commented here. If you're using Raspbian, the client address may be null. So this is actually a bug on Raspbian, because maybe the Bluetooth stack is quite out of date. Okay, so here, on char LED written, so this function is called whenever the central sends the letter B or Y. So you can see here, if the data received is B, I'll toggle the blue. If it's Y, I'll toggle the yellow. So, okay, then for the final part of this function, here, this is actually not required since my characteristics is without response, but I just include here for reference. So if the property is right, that means the peripheral must respond back with the acknowledgement. So the acknowledgement here is result success. Okay, any questions up to now? Okay, let me move on. Okay, so now I'll move on to iOS. So the same thing, the three files, the view controller, handler, and the callback. So this last year, the BLE handler, this will handle all the iOS APIs related to BLE. Then the view controller here, this is the user interface. So the reason I'm doing this is so that, I'm separating out the roles into these classes. The callback here, this is to prevent a tight coupling between the UI and the handler. Okay, any questions? Okay, so I move on to the iOS code. Okay, so we can see here, these are the three files, the view controller, delegate, and the BLE handler. Okay, yeah. So the device I'm using is iPod Touch, iOS 8.3. Language is Swift. So I understand that Swift is actually a very new language. So if you all don't understand what the syntax associated with Swift, feel free to stop me anytime to ask. Okay? So let me first start with the delegate. This one. Okay, so you can see here, steps 2, 3, 4, 5. So each function here corresponds to each part of the connection process. Here. 2, 3, 4, 5. So whenever the connection goes through each of these steps, the BLE handler will call these methods, which will be implemented by the UI. Okay. So now let me go to the handler. So you can see here. So I've already set down all these UIDs because I know that my peripheral will have them. Okay. So now the same thing. This data structure. This is actually a hash table. So the reason I have this hash table, right, is to track which devices I've already found. This is because for the Bluetooth advertisement packets, they come continuously. So I need a way to filter them. So this is how I filter, using a dictionary. Okay, so I begin with step 1. So step 1 happens when I want to look for devices. So I'll tell the API to scan for peripheral. Okay, so I receive the packet here. This is step 2. So here actually there's a bug on iOS because this device name, right, it cannot be null by the specification. But I've seen that it has given null device names before. That's why I do a check here. If it's device not null, then I proceed. So if it's not null, then after that I'll check whether I've already seen this device before. If I've not seen it before, then I'll store it. And then I'll tell the user interface, which is here, that I've seen this new device. Okay, so once I've seen this device, I'll attempt to connect to it. So here, so I've added an extra step, connection attempt step 2.5. So step 2.5 here, I'll connect to the peripheral. Step 2.5, okay? So after step 2.5 is step 3. I assume the connection will be successful. So this method here will be called. So the next step will be discover services. Step 3 to here. So I'm discovering services here. So after step 3, come on. Step 4. So services data will be returned by the peripheral. So this is step 4. So after I discover services, I have to discover characteristics. So if you have seen my previous talk, right, for Android, once you discover services, it's equal to discovering everything. But for iOS, it's not. Once you discover service, you only discover service. You need to discover the characteristic as well. That is why I'm doing this. So this is actually moving from here to here. So now once we discover the characteristics, we are done already. Except for one more step here. This is to set notification. So earlier you realized that, my peripheral has a property here, notify. So this means that I need to register. The central needs to tell the peripheral that I want to listen to changes in this value. So that's why I need to set a notify value true here. Okay. So what happens when I press a button? I press it here. So this particular function will be called did update value for characteristics. So you can see, once I receive this value, then I'll tell the user interface that I receive 1 or 2. Okay, so what about if I were to, if I want the peripheral to blink blue or yellow? So here, the user interface will call this. Send toggle blue, send toggle yellow. You send the letters B or Y. Then this function will be called. I'll convert it to byte. So NSData in iOS actually means a byte array. So I write the value. And that's how the peripheral receives it. Okay. Any questions now? at this point? No questions? Okay. Okay, so let me move on. Okay, iOS issues. So there are some issues on iOS as well, but not as serious as Android. So in an iOS, right, you cannot retrieve the MAC address. Yes, this is actually a problem. So it means that you cannot actually identify whether, okay, for example, if iPhone and iPad, if I were to scan the same device, I cannot be sure that both of them are actually scanning the same device. What you actually get is a UID. So this UID actually, you see here, this is the one. But the problem is this UID is actually randomly generated on each device. So the only solution, right, is actually the peripheral must send additional data back. So in Innova Technology, in the previous company I worked in, what they did was they embedded the MAC address inside the manufacturer data field of the advertisement packet. Another way is in my current company, Argo SS, I embedded the MAC address inside the device or local name. So this is one case where the limitations of the peripheral cause you to, limitation in the central cause you to program something extra in the peripheral. Then the next issue is aggressive caching of get data. So the problem is, right, if this happens during the development of a peripheral, if you are like doing something, okay, then suddenly I'll add an extra characteristic in, then I try to scan again, you realize that I still only get back one characteristic, the original characteristic. I don't receive the new characteristic. So this is because, right, iOS aggressively cache it. Once it connects to it once, right, you will not pull it again. It assumes that the peripheral is the same, it returns you the same data. So the only way out is you have to restart the Bluetooth on the iOS device every single time, whenever you change something in the peripheral. Then the max number of PLA connections are 20. This is online anecdotes, I've not actually tested this. So no, that's more than enough compared to Android. Okay, so okay. This is actually a low level concept. Before I move on to the sniffer, I need to give extra information first. So this is actually a BLE layer model. Okay. So this looks very familiar, right? If you've seen the OSI layer model, this looks almost similar. So you realize that the concepts I covered earlier, the gap and get, these are actually very high up in the stack. So if we sniff packets, we'll be sniffing the entire lower level protocols. So that's why I'm going through this first. Okay, so the link layer, which is here. So this defines how two BLE devices communicate. So it's in charge of advertisement, scanning, collecting, and the packet format. Okay, so now the convention here is master and slave instead of central and peripheral. Central and peripheral is normally only used high up. So I shall follow the convention by chipset manufacturers to use the term master and slave here. Okay, so L2 cap. So this is actually short for this, logical link control and adaptation protocol. So this is responsible for this segmentation and reassembly of packets. So this is 4 byte hazards, 23 bytes for the MTU. So this is actually, it also does protocol multiplexing. So yeah, these three basically, but today we'll be focusing only on this because this is the most common, ATT channel. Okay, so what is ATT? So ATT is short for attribute protocol. So this is actually the action to be taken. So whenever you do a read characteristic, write characteristic, anything is done through ATT. So this is actually a 1 byte instruction output, 2 byte handle. So 2 byte handle stores the service characteristic and descriptor to be operated on. And so this is actually where this 20 byte MTU comes from. Because here is 23 bytes, you minus 1, minus 2, you have left 20. So this is where 20 byte MTU for the application.
So just one big question, so the UUID is converted into a 2 byte handle?
Okay, yeah, good question, right? Because 128 bit UID is longer than this, right? So actually a unique handle is being assigned after that. Okay, so this is actually the packet structure. So there's actually only one packet structure in BLE. So here, we have advertising data access address. So preamble, this is actually for calibration only. So this is called the protocol and packet data unit, this section. Okay, so there are two types of packets, advertisement packets and data packets. So for advertisement packets, this one here will always have this particular value. This is actually a hard-coded constant. But for data packets, this is random. So this is actually decided by the master. So you can see here, it allows master and slave to distinguish packets. The MAC address is no longer used. So the reason for the Bluetooth SIG doing this is because they don't want people, like if I sniff it, right, I know which two devices are communicating. So inside here, the payload, it carries the payload of the higher level protocols, L2 cap and ATT. So Okay, I'll move on to this first. So the header format is advertising and data is not the same for this. Okay, so this is actually the sniffer I'm using. So this is actually based on Nordic. This is by Adafruit. So the problem with this is that the software is Windows only. Okay, so okay, let me move on. Okay, so now any questions before? I need to restart my computer already. So yeah, because it's Windows only. Yeah, here. I'm running Mac. So any questions before I move on? No, I okay. I restart my computer now. Without the sniffer now.
Alright.
I'm not sure. How much more time left?
No more.
No more time, wow. Okay,
minutes.
So do you want the sniffer a lot?
Let's have that.
Okay.
Any questions in the meantime?
Yeah,
okay, maybe
ask,
you can
ask now, yeah.
Yeah. Questions for VLE?
Oh, no questions at this time. So I'll take out the entire Q&A time then.
Yeah.
The screen has changed. Where's my shortcut?
Right, there are many of you standing there, and here is one seat. There are two seats here. You want to come in? Don't be shy.
So, to speed things up, let me connect first.
Yeah. Yeah, behind the dining table there as well, so you can move in. You can sit there, so far.
Okay. Okay, so let me see. Okay, so now let's look here. Okay, so this is actually the advertisement packet. So you can see here, this is actually from the slave to the master. You can see the advertisement data, the UUID. Then now I'll attempt to connect already. So here, this is connect request. So this is actually issued from the master to the slave. Okay, let's look here. So scan request. So this will ask. Sorry, let's move back. I missed out one part. Okay. So normally the advertisement packet is just not enough. So that's why whenever I do a scan, right? Actually, there's a scan request and scan response. So this is actually a scan request. It asks the central asks the peripheral for more data. So you can look at the scan request, scan response. The response contains the name. So you can see that the advertisement is not exactly just a one-way thing. Actually, there's two way involved here. So the connection procedure, you can see connect request. So this is actually the PDU type. So the PDU type here actually defines what type of advertisement packet is this. Sorry. Okay. So PDU type. So it's actually this field, 0101. Okay. So this empty PDU packet, right, keep alive packet, I've actually like removed from here because it basically clutters up the whole thing. So I removed it, so I filtered it away. That's why I'm doing this. So data packets. So data packets are different from advertisement packets. So they usually carry L2 cap ATT data. Okay. So we can look here. Let's move forward. Here. So after we connect, we need to discover services. So here 0x10. So this is the ATT code. So group by type request. Read by group type request. 0x10. Okay, yeah. Okay, 0x10 here. So once I discover services, the peripheral must respond. So this is what it's doing. 0x11 here. Read by group type response. So after you discover services, you have to discover characteristics. Right? So this 0x08. See here? 0x08. Then the peripheral respond. Read by type response. 0x09. The ATT opcode. Okay, so what about data transfer? So earlier we saw that the central sends a letter B or Y to the peripheral. At the same time, the peripheral can send back a notification. So this is actually 0x52. So let's try to find it. Do I have it? Yes, write request. Hey, no, not this. Type response. Yes, this one. Write command. So you can see here, write command 0x52. And I write the value 62. So 62 is a ASCII code for the letter B. Similarly for the other one, I write the letter Y. So 0x52, value 79, ASCII code for the letter Y. So, okay, last one already lah. Okay, so last one, handle value notification. So you can see here, 0x1B, value 31, short for the value 1. Yeah, the end.
Alright, so, thank you. We may have just one question for King Ming, and if not, of course, after the entire thing, we can also ask him. Any one question?
How much cost the stiffer?
Sorry?
How much is the cost of the stiffer?
Oh, stiffer, this one I think is $40.
$40.
But for the better one, the Ubertooth one, right, I think it's $120. Yeah.
Where do you get a stiffer?
This Adafruit.
Why would you normally need a stiffer?
Actually, it's sometimes new diagnose Bluetooth issues. So sometimes if a connection cannot go through for some reason, right, if I'm designing a very special like protocol or something, right, then you cannot go through, then maybe you want to like sniff the packets to check. Yeah. And also, you'll notice that, that I'm using Arduino now instead of Raspberry Pi. Because for some reason, the packets on Raspberry Pi keeps crashing the stiffer software. For some reason, yeah. Okay, yeah.
Is this software for the Windows sniffer open source?
I think it's not. It's by Nordic themselves.
Okay. Alright, thank you. So, more questions for him after the entire thing. Thank you, King Ming.
Okay.